Listen, Mike and Roman's weekend best.
Well, the good news is, when you see our faces, you know it means it's the weekend! But the bad news is, we're only here for an hour. But we've got a fun hour just for you!
With us today is football legend and one all-round unbelievable guy, Chris Kamara.
Yes, thank you.
I must have a text. That is a phrase that will absolutely haunt our next guest for the rest of his life. But he's our type on paper. It's Love Island's Kem Cetinay.
And it will be Saturday without heading into the kitchen and a cookery lesson with our resident chef, Shivi Ramoutar.
Yes.
What are we cooking today, Shiv?
So today we've got coming up a delicious, quick, simple chicken kebab with a refreshing tzatziki.
No, that's my favourite.
Yes, lovely little kebab.
Ooh.
Fancy that? Very good. Right, let's kick-start the conversation this morning with a little music question. OK, we love doing this. Which song was number one on this day in the year 2000. OK, I'm actually going to start with you, Chris. Think back the year 2000.
You've got to think back to where you were. That's the only way I can ever do it.
Right. It's a football-related song.
Great call.
Yeah.
Great call. What's the song?
Beautiful Day, You Too.
Loving that.
Bit of Match of the Day theme music for a long time, that one as well.
Won it just,
Okay, all right. Kem, what about you?
Guys, I'll be honest with you, I'm trying to think back to the time I was 5 years old at this time, so I was probably running around, like, I don't know what I was doing.
Ouch! Get him out!
All I could think about that time, you know, the Crazy Frog song that was, like, number one for ages.
It's a good shout.
Yeah.
It's the closest I could get.
It's a good shout.
5 years old.
Crazy Frog is a good shout. It was number one for a long time as well. Dad, what do you reckon?
Yeah, what were you? You were about seven, weren't you?
Yeah, would have been seven years old.
7 years old, right? Yeah. Well, then, your crush at that time would have been Britney Spears. He was all over Britney Spears.
All right, chill out.
Well, when she came on television, you would stand there that far away from the television, staring at her.
Weird.
Yeah. So I'm going Britney Spears. Maybe, oops, I did it again.
No wonder you got dodgy eyes. Yeah.
That's not the only reason.
What does that even mean? Anyway, look, the answer is, of course, yes. Keating's number one hit, Life is a Roller Coaster, and his debut album, Ronan, which sold 4.4 million copies worldwide. I mean, he had an illustrious singing career. He got to perform in so many places that were just incredible and perform in front of so many famous faces, including Prince Charles at the Tower of London and for the Pope twice.
Wow.
Which did get me thinking. You guys both part-time.
I love it best when he says nothing at all.
Very good, Karen. Very good. I love that you've set the bar there. I love it. Look, guys, you are both performers. You're used to getting
are
up
we?
On stage in different ways. Yes. Kem, you have a very successful rap career. So what I want to know, who is the most famous person you've ever either sung in front of or rapped in front of? Or sung. You may have done karaoke.
Mine was Stormzy.
You rapped in front of Stormzy. Yeah. Oh, on the show!
On the show, and he brought me to V-Fest afterwards to watch him, and then before he went out, I thought it was a good idea to practice in front of him to see what he thought.
What did he think?
Not too great. Yeah. He said there was room for improvement.
Yeah, room for improvement. Cammy, what about you?
You might not know this fella. Okay. His name is Daniel O'Donnell.
Daniel O'Donnell. Do you know this guy?
No, I don't.
He's a legend!
Who is he, Karen?
He's an Irish singer, legend. I had a share in an Irish bar in Tenerife, the Hole in the Wall. Yeah. Not share anymore. And Daniel came along and used to sing. I always used to get up and throw out a tune.
Dad, what about you? Have you performed in front of anyone famous of note?
Yeah, everyone.
Where does he start?
Yeah, who haven't I performed in front of?
Who's the most famous?
Oh, I don't know, what about this? What about, have you performed in front of... have you performed in front of the Pope?
No, not that one.
Have you performed in front of the Queen?
No.
The Beckhams?
No, not
the Clooneys?
No.
The Pitts?
No.
Not as good as Ronan Keating, then, are you? now, this is obviously... Yeah, it is. Look, this is obviously a safe place here, and I think it's fair to say that we all agree that the show that is dominating our summer currently Love Island. It's proving to be as addictive as ever. So who better to host its morning after spin-off show than a previous winner? Kem, thanks so much for joining us today, bud. Mate, now, obviously, I have to go straight in with your time in the villa. Do you miss it or do you prefer being a spectator?
I do miss it. It was a once-in-a-lifetime experience that I'll never, like, have again. And it's so many people always ask me about it, you know. It's a once-in-a-lifetime experience. But I am glad to be out and be a spectator and watch it, you know. I don't want to be in there. I feel like I'm too old for it now.
I genuinely feel
like I'm too old and I'm 25.
How old were you when you were in there?
I just turned 21.
That's crazy.
Do you know what I'm always fascinated with? Do you have any regrets about going on that show?
Well, where do I start? do you know what? I'm going to be brutally honest with you guys. I wish I wasn't as explicit because I didn't think my nan and granddad in Cyprus would be watching.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
But do you know what? They didn't mind. Well, I don't know.
They're seeing, seeing you live your life, you know, and I think, you know...
I saw a bit too much, Roman.
Yeah, I know, yeah. I know, yeah. But look, Kem, you know, you're often joined by, you know, eliminated contestants. Do you end up giving them advice, you know, either on the podcast or after the podcast?
Yeah, I do. They always seem to ask a lot of questions and they want to know, because what people forget is they go in as genuine, just normal people. I remember I was just a barber before, working on Hornchurch High Street, went in and suddenly you come out and everyone knows your name. So it is a mad experience for them. So I try and give them a bit of advice and for them to understand and just take it in their stride and enjoy it. But the show's just getting bigger and bigger every year.
Yeah, it is. And look, we've got to talk about it as well. ITV has obviously been really open about changing their duty of care protocol for the contestants, specifically, I think, from a mental health point of view. I mean, do you think, you know, enough is being done to help the contestants as they leave the villa?
Yeah, I do. I think the most important thing is that they're doing more every year. Yeah. You know, I had a good experience with it when I come off the show, and I know a lot of people have spoken out about it, but the most important thing is that I know that every year they're pushing to do more, and what I see from the contestants now, what they're getting is a lot more than what we was getting. I think that's the most important thing.
100%.
It's got to go that way, though, isn't it? It's got to. You've got a new show out called The Full Treatment.
Yeah.
Right? Tell us why it's so important to you.
So The Full Treatment is around mental health, and it's something that I feel really, really passionate about, and it brings me back to when I was a barber and I used to work in the barbers, and I used to have all these conversations with my clients and they used to open up to me. And I thought it's such a good idea to do that with people from the industry or TV or anything, and they can talk about their life and experiences, and hopefully people at home watching can understand and take things from it. And we do lots of different things, like coping mechanisms. They open up about their life, and and it's been good. A lot of good reaction to it, and I loved it. You know, it was interesting. It was quite an emotional show to film.
You with Anne McGill.
Yeah, so she does like the female. Like the nails and stuff, I can't do that.
But
you're talking about coping mechanisms, right? We've got a little bit of film, haven't we?
Yeah.
So don't judge. No judgment in this room. Dance therapy, love it.
Talking my language.
Yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Kem, I can't cope with you. Look at him.
Ooh. See the hips, it's all in the hips.
I like the
hips. Check the foot. Check the foot. If you want to go with me, just go with me.
What is like, whip my hair?
If you want to get low, you can get low with me.
See, I love that, because that is what we do.
Nothing wrong with it.
My family do that. We go, you know, in the kitchen, around the kitchen, we'll get up and we dance, and it's fun.
Do you know what? All jokes aside, I know I get a lot of stick from the boys about that dancing, but honestly, sometimes, like with everything that's gone on over the last year, sometimes just dancing makes such a difference to people's moods.
Yeah.
And like, just go for it, just have a laugh, and I think that's the most important thing. I just having a laugh. Look, I know my dancing ain't great, guys.
It doesn't have to be, though.
Romans ain't much better, let's be honest. Romans ain't much better.
I'll admit that and not put it on television.
Have you found anything else that works for you?
I'll be honest, something I live by is cold showers.
Oh, yeah.
I've been doing them for about over a year now. I have freezing cold showers every morning for about 3 minutes. And it just does something to my mood. It just does something to my morale every day. I don't know what it is, but I just find them amazing.
I speak for probably, I think, every other human being. When I say, how do you approach a cold shower? Do you start underneath it, then turn it on?
Yeah.
Or do you have to turn it on, get yourself ready, go on,
Go on. So go on.
Did you go back in first?
No. You can't go in freezing. You've got to go in like medium temperature and then keep going colder till it gets really, really cold.
Okay.
Yeah. No, you get used to the temperature. As it gets colder, you get used to the temperature.
Yeah, because your body goes
into
shock.
Yeah, you get used to it.
I know, it's 3 minutes. It's a long time.
No, it's lovely. Please try it, guys.
I will.
Please.
I will, 100%. Hey, mate, look, maybe we'll actually get to try it together. Not in a weird way, Dad. Don't think
about it.
No, Soccer Aid.
Oh,
we're teaming up once again. I mean, I don't know about you, but I've had a gammy foot for some time. Have you managed to get any training in?
No, and I'm waiting for you. We trained together, didn't we?
I know. Cammy, any tips on two completely out of shape?
Well, footballs? I've commented on commentary on the Soccer Aid a few years, and some of the pros are okay. Some of them are not. Some of the celebs are useless. and some of them are not. So, where in the football world would you see yourself?
I think we should speak about each other. That's only fair, isn't it, Rose?
You know how you said some of them aren't as good and some of them are very good?
Yeah.
That's basically us.
Right.
Yeah.
Not very
good. I'm the good one.
Whoa!
What position?
To be honest, we always agree. I think each year it's just so we just want to be able to. So we both play for the World 11 team, right? So I was born in the States, so I represent the World 11 team.
Yeah.
Kem, obviously with his Turkish background, represents the World 11, and I think we see how serious the England players are. Your Mark Wrights, Ollie Mears. I'll put this on television. I know this year Ollie Mears has requested a personal chef and his own and his own personal physio.
Of course, takes it serious.
Why does he need a physio?
Honestly.
Like, and so as long as we go out there, as long as they're crying at the end of it, it's great.
Good thing is we're unbeaten.
Yeah.
We still ain't lost.
Ollie Mears always wanted to be a footballer.
Yeah.
Wanted to play for Manchester United.
Yeah. But can he's not.
I know he's not, but this is his opportunity to show people how good he is. And he's not bad, to be fair.
I did once get told at a Soccer Aid, this is my favourite thing ever. I got told by Mark Wright at Soccer Aid once that Mourinho pulled him aside and said, would he like a trial at Man United?
I sorted that.
I can't.
No way!
Yeah, I did.
So you can verify that story?
I can verify that story. I was talking to Jose, I was doing the commentary in training, just for a lap, basically. And Jose was stood next to me, and he went, he's not bad, is he? And I went,
no way.
Fancy giving him a trial? And he said, I'd consider it. So I told Mark straight away, and he was magnificent from then on.
Oh, you know what? I've thought that story was a lie for a
We both did. We laughed at it for about 2 days.
Yeah, 2 days.
100% true.
I love you being on this show because their faces are like that. It's true.
I can't believe
it. Two people it's so true.
Jose
like
Mourinho, say that about.
Kevin, thank you so much for being with us this morning. And you can see the full treatment on ITV Hub now.
Yes, time for a quick break, but when we're back, what's coming up, Cammy?
I don't know, Jeff.
We're talking all things Yorkshire with Chris Kamara.
And Shivi's in the kitchen rustling up the delicious quick chicken kebab. See you in a bit. Weekend best, Chris Kamara.
Yes.
Kem Cetinay with us all morning.
And shortly we're heading into the kitchen for a cooking lesson with Shivi.
Right now, he's a former professional footballer, a manager, a much-loved sports pundit, TV host, chart-topping singer, and now podcaster. Chris, you're not slowing down in your age, are you?
Well, I am, but TV-wise, I'm not.
Yeah.
I seem to be working more than ever, but we saw each other recently, right?
Oh, we
did. Yeah, you did. I mean, so my dad was on your podcast, Cammy Supporters Club.
Yeah.
He was saying that there's a funny story about how you guys first met. You were talking about that. What happened?
It was incredible. After doing Ninja Warrior, I got invited to the NTAs. As part of it with ITV. And so I go into the room, hospitality room, at the O2 Arena.
Yeah.
Yeah. So first person in there, I think I am, but your dad appears walking towards me. And I went, hello, and quickly exited out the front. Got on the phone to my missus and I went, you never guess who I've just met. She went, who? So I went, Martin Kemp. She went, what did you say to him? I said, hello. Was I it? I said, yeah. I couldn't think of anything else to say. Because we love Spandau Ballet and we love Wham, your mum as well. So it was one of those moments where you don't know what to say. I don't know whether he knows me at all, you know.
So listen, I didn't know what to say when you said hello. But you got yourself a new podcast, right? Chris Kamara podcast with Plusnet.
Yes, I have, yeah. It's for Yorkshire Today, which is on August the 1st. It's incredible. We've had some wonderful guests on it. And it's all about Yorkshire.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, which is why you were on with Keith Lemon.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, well, Keith Lemon's from Leeds, New Farnley in Leeds. I'm from Middlesbrough, which was North Yorkshire back in the day when I was born.
And you were discussing one of life's big questions.
Yes.
We've got a clip. Let's have a look.
Is it a scone or a scun?
It's a scone. What is a scone? That means it's just gone. Scone. It's a scone. It's just gone. Scone, isn't it?
Yeah.
We all know a scone is posh, isn't it?
Yes.
No, because it ain't even the right word. It's a scone.
It's a scone.
It's a scone.
I say scone.
No, you
domestics, don't ask me.
You do not say scone.
Say scone sometimes.
Wait, you've gone so posh. Since Love Island.
Oh, no, honestly.
You've gone so
it's
posh.
It's changed, Ro.
Honestly.
It's changed.
Yeah, I even have the ones with raisins in it.
That's Altana.
I've gone clear.
But what's an even bigger question is, do you put the jam on first or the cream on first?
I put the cream on first.
No! You cannot put the cream on first.
Why?
I like the jam at the top because I can put loads.
The cream goes on top. Don't you know the phrase, the cream, it goes to the top? Do you not know?
Is that a so famous saying?
Of course it is!
It's a saying!
Well, it's
the
my famous saying. Have you not heard that?
No!
Cream always goes to the top.
No. Oh, dear, wow.
The cream goes on top, please! Help me, someone!
I would say, look, there's a lot of people that agree with you. The only reason I would agree with the cream on the bottom, right, is... because I feel like it makes a decent base jam.
Yeah.
Oh, he's so offended. I'm so sorry. Carry on, take it back. I take it back.
Got you. But we saw you there with fellow Yorkshiremen, like you said, you know, Keith
Lemon.
You have had a little bit of trouble with some celebrities, right? Let's just tell us what's going on here.
Oh. Channing Tatum.
Yes. I did Chatty Man.
Alan Carr.
Yeah, Alan Carr. And I was in the green room. So we're watching the two Dyers are on there with him from the green room. So Danny and Danielle. Yeah. So I go to the fridge, I get a beer out, say to this bloke, do you want a beer? He goes, no. It's OK, thanks. So I'm sat there drinking my beer. He gets called next. He goes down, goes onto the stage. He gets a 5-minute standing ovation. I'm thinking, crikey. So I phoned my wife and I said, have you heard of a fella called Channing Tatum? She goes, of course I have. So I said, oh, yeah, I was just in the green room. He's just got a 5-minute standing ovation. He went, can you get a picture with him? Eve, my daughter-in-law, loves him. So I said, yeah, of course, I'm on next. So I'll go down and get it. So the runner comes for me, takes me down. Channing Tatum comes off. Alan Carr's been gyrating on the floor and all that sort of stuff. So he comes out. So I said, can I have a selfie? So he goes, yeah, of course you can. So I get my phone out. Anyway, Google Channing Tatum on my phone. Right? And I went, sorry, I don't know who you are, but my wife loves you. Not even my daughter-in-law. You can't see on there, but he's got his two fingers. He let me know in a subtle way.
Oh, amazing.
Amazing.
He didn't know who he was.
Listen, if your punditry and your podcast aren't keeping you busy enough, you also keep farm animals.
Yeah, I love
animals. What animals are you keeping?
We've got sheep, horses, chickens, ducks, cats.
What do you do with them?
We love
Just like
pets.
Oh, like
yeah, yeah. The grandkids love them. I love them. Animals are so great.
Are they allowed in the house?
Yeah, yeah. Chickens come in, sheep come in. Yeah.
I think it's lovely because those animals just bring you peace, don't they? That's what I get from them when I'm in, you know, on a farm or something.
They love you. If you look after an animal, that looks after you because they love you.
Yeah.
Well, look, Cammy, in honour of your Yorkshire roots, we thought we'd see just how well you know your home county in a game we're calling... This is York Live. It's a little bit of a stretch, Cammy, I know, but we're working on the title. Look, Cammy, I'm going to ask you a series of Yorkshire-based questions, and if you get them all right, you will not only be crowned a top Yorkshireman, but you'll also take home this. Oh, yeah! The golden flat cap.
Oh.
You, sir, will be the envy of Yorkshire. OK, Cammy, are you ready for your first question?
Yeah, let's go.
Let's put some time on the clock, please, as well. Here we go. Cammy, if I was to pinch your Gansey, what would I be doing?
No idea.
Gansey?
Gansey?
I've got down here. Stealing your jumper.
Gansey.
Never heard of that one.
Heard of that one. All right. You sure you're from Yorkshire?
Yeah.
Question two. Right. Where in Yorkshire was the world's first football club?
World's Sheffield.
It was indeed. Well done. Next question. Correct me if I'm saying this wrong. What happens if you are in Tut Pudding Club?
You're pregnant.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
In Tut Pudding Club, like that. Yes, you are. Right. What is a Yorkshire fat rascal?
A fat rascal is a scone.
Yeah, well, I've got here, it's a cake which is a cross between a rock cake and a scone.
Oh, is that scone?
See?
Okay.
Yeah,
scone.
Very good. Near enough. I'll take you that one.
A scone. That's a scone.
That's a scone.
Very good. Finally, Cammy, other than Keith Lemon, who you mentioned earlier, name one other famous person from Yorkshire.
Michael Parkinson.
Very good. Cammy, do you know what, sir? This... is yours.
Can I wear it now?
Yes. Oh, you may. Absolutely.
It was that close.
Cammy, thank you so much for being here with us this morning. Absolute pleasure, really is. And your podcast, Chris Kamara with Plusnet, is available to listen to from August the 1st.
Yes, after the break. What are we doing, Cammy?
I don't know, Jeff.
No, we're heading to the kitchen to join our in-house chef, Shivi, who's making some amazing chicken kebabs.
Yeah, see you then. Weekend best.
We have moved to our kitchen with our resident chef, the ravishing Shivi Ramoutar. Shiv, lovely to see you. Yeah.
Always lovely to be here, you know.
Shiv, you look beautiful today.
It's summer, sun. Yeah, enjoy it.
What are you trying to do? Get brownie points?
well,
before you cook?
Just it's my turn to cook today.
All right, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, right. I'm going to make it easy for you. Well, you know, Rose's been on my case for the last few weeks for this dish. He did such a good job last weekend, I thought I'd treat him to some quick chicken kebabs.
Oh!
You know what? My favourite. Absolutely.
Yeah. You're going to need an apron though, right, Martin?
I do, yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So...
what we got?
Shirley has sent this lovely little spiffy number.
What, my Shirley?
How many Shirleys do you know?
Oh!
My mum's given you an Elvis apron.
Oh, Elvis!
Are you a fan of Elvis, though?
Thank
you, Shirley. No, don't even go there, Shiv. Basically, it's some weird fantasy that I'd rather not talk about.
All right, let's move swiftly
on. Yeah, move on.
That's a bit dodge for me. OK, so, chicken kebabs, This, for me, screams summer, right? It's grilled meat, it's lots of gorgeous fresh salad items, it's a refreshing tzatziki, which is a yogurt cucumber sauce.
Yeah.
OK, let's start with marinating. So I've got here boneless and skinless chicken thighs.
Yep.
That's going to be marinated. I always go for thighs for this rather than breasts because this is juicier, it's got more flavour, and it's a lot cheaper.
Yeah.
So this is the way forward. And into our marinade, we've got 4 teaspoons of oregano, 2 of paprika, 2 of cumin, 1 clove of garlic, grated.
Ooh.
And I'm also going to add the zest and juice of 1 lemon. So let's start with that, shall we?
Yeah.
So there are a lot of gorgeous Mediterranean flavours going in here. This is very loosely inspired by a Greek souvlaki, because I think that was your exact request, wasn't it?
Souvlaki is another realm. But I just like anything, to be honest, Shiv, anything with tzatziki, I'm in. Tzatziki and a flatbread, I'm there.
That is, do you know what? Especially in this weather when it's so hot.
Perfect.
Yeah, forget jumping into a pool. I need a big vat of tzatziki to swim in. That is the way forward.
Oh, goodness, make my mouth.
I know. Sunshine lemon. So there are a lot of fresh, gorgeous flavours going in here. Originally, souvlaki would have been with pork, so you can absolutely use cuts of pork, pork shoulder, diced pork. You can also use lamb as well.
Yeah.
But I do love a chicken, and it's a really great way to buy chicken in bulk, open it up, freeze it individually so you can have it whenever you want. So get all that lovely lemon in here.
Do you know what someone once showed me, right? If you do it like this, squeeze your lemon like that, catch all the pips.
I know, but we don't even need to bother about that, Martin, because we're going to be picking the chicken up and putting it on our rack, so we don't even have to go that extra step, as wonderful as it is. Mm. Olive oil, we need about 4 tablespoons.
You know me, though, Shiv, just full of tips.
You are full of tips. I've got to watch out. I'm not going to have a job at the end of this, am I? Martin? Yeah. Martin's going to be taking it. So about 4 tablespoons of olive oil in there, and then all of our spices. What I want to say about these spices that have gone in here, if you are a bit of a spice phobe, this is a perfect starting point, these 3 spices and herbs here, because between these three, do you know how many cuisines you can make? You can make Indian from that, Italian, Mexican, Caribbean.
Yeah.
It's a really good starting point if you're a spice phobe. Buy those, get it in your spice rack, spice up your life on a day-to-day basis.
See, my dad used to have a go at me. My dad used to have a go at me for mixing paprika and cumin in the same thing.
Why?
Why?
Because you're like, it's too much in there. I come in the kitchen, it's all I can smell. No, it's in the back of my throat.
He's going, like a kid, he's going, oh,
sure, I need water.
Well, I'm going to tell you
something. If you put those spices on a piece of chicken and you put it under the grill, right, then you get this kind of like aroma that goes down the back of your throat.
Yeah.
Hold on a minute. We are going to be putting this in the grill today.
Well, it's going to go down the back of my throat.
No, but we've tempered it. I don't know how much spice Ro put on this, his home creation, but we've got it all. I've written a great recipe for you guys. Don't worry, it's going to be wonderful.
And you could jazz this up as well. If you do like a little bit of a kick, you could add
chili.
Yeah. I mean, my favourite thing about going into a kebab shop is also not only just calling the man behind the till boss in every sentence, but also asking for chili sauce, boss.
Oh, yeah, and garlic sauce, all the extras.
Yeah, chili sauce, boss. Burger sauce, boss. Garlic sauce, boss. Chips and cheese, boss.
Is this all going on your kebab?
No, I'm just saying, that's normally the rundown, yeah.
Yeah, okay. That's because when he goes in the kebab shop, he's always drunk, standing by that kebab, turning round.
Exactly.
Isn't that chili quite sauce, standard? Yeah. That's quite standard, isn't it?
What?
Buying a kebab, being a bit...
Oh, yeah, it's great.
So, have you mixed everything in there, Martin?
I have. You know what?
Bit of salt.
I forgot to say, along with my tips, you know, the lemon juice actually tenderizes the chicken.
It does, Martin.
It doesn't just taste good, tenderizes.
I'm getting nervous. I'm really going to be out of a job now. Okay, so I'm going to pop this into the fridge to marinate for 4 hours at least, ideally overnight. You know, I also love marinating in the freezer. Great way to always have meat ready to go.
Yep.
So let's pop that in. And I'm going to grab my marinated version. Now, just have a whiff of that. Just have a whiff. It's all mellowed together so beautifully,
that's
hasn't it?
So good.
It's great. So, this is when we get grilly with it.
Mm.
I've got a rack ready for you here, Martin, and I'm just going to pop the thighs out onto the rack. And just when you're doing it, make sure it isn't all wrapped up. So look at this. We're stretching it all out. We don't want any of the thigh to curl up, yeah?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right, so this is going to go under a really hot grill for about 15 to 20 minutes. And halfway through, I'm going to turn it over. And I'm going to keep basting it. So we've got a little brush to keep basting all those gorgeous juices back on top so it stays juicy and it's going to be charred. It's going to be amazing.
Do you know what I learnt this week, Shiv?
What did you learn?
Because obviously the week's been pretty hot and lots of people are having barbecue. I learnt that there's people out there that are as lazy as me.
So what are we talking about exactly?
They put the disposable barbecues on their own barbecues so they don't have to clean it up.
I do that.
You do it!
All right.
What's the point of having a barbecue?
I do that.
Yeah. That is quite lazy.
I have a barbecue sitting on top. Yeah. So I can just throw it away.
Yeah.
So, Martin, pop yours in the bottom grill. 15 to 20 minutes. Flip over halfway through. Keep basting those gorgeous juices all over that chicken. There we go.
There we go.
Brilliant. OK, we're going to make our tzatziki.
Yeah.
So I've got 8 tablespoons of Greek yogurt. I've gone Greek here because we're keeping this tzatziki thick.
Right.
You do not want it watering down.
Yeah,
so, and I've also grated a clove of garlic. Yeah. I'm also going to add mint. Now, you know I'm normally a use everything, but with mint, it's a lot more woody as stalk than, for example, coriander or parsley. So I'm going to pull the leaves off it, but we're still not going to get rid of the stalk. We're going to use this. You can pop it into mojitos, into a big jug of sparkling water and lemon, so you can use it and get all that lovely minty flavour without having to worry about the bite. So this, apparently, is Ro's favourite part of the dish. Yeah, tzatziki?
Yes, mate. I absolutely love it. It's the only thing you'll catch me eating cucumber with.
Put it that way.
So mint going in.
Right.
Right. And then cucumber. You can't have a tzatziki without cucumber. Now, just watch this a second, Martin. With the cucumber,
yeah,
it's 96% water. So we want to scrape away a lot of the seeds because that's where a lot of the water is. And we're trying to make this as thick as possible. So just scrape down the middle like that. All right. So this, again, doesn't need to be wasted. There's a lovely cucumber seed.
You're spitting all over me. It's not my fault. I said I like it. I don't want to smell like it.
So other than using this to squirt yourself with, you can also put it in water again or into cocktails, so you don't have to waste these bits. Cucumber, mojito with the mint stalks, winner. All right, so pop those aside. And then I'm going to use my box grater, the coarse side.
Yeah.
We're just going to grate in with this. I mean, it is like summer slapped you in its face when you have cucumber, right? It's so refreshing, and with that mint, it is beautiful. Okay, so squeeze that into your same cucumber bowl. There's still loads of water coming from that.
So you want to dry it out a little bit?
Yeah, because you don't want your tzatziki to be too watery. And give that a good mix. And what you'll find, actually, over the course of a, you know, if you have this half an hour beforehand, it will still become a little bit more liquidy. So don't worry if it looks too thick. It will become a little bit more watery.
Oh,
and look
perfect.
At that. Give that a little try as well. It takes quite a lot of seasoning, so give yourself a lot of seasoning there, Martin.
Right.
Right, so that chicken has had about 7 minutes.
Yeah.
I think we need a bit of TV magic, Martin, to get that to its full 15, 20 minute.
Bit of TV magic?
Yeah.
Very good.
Yep.
All right.
And the TV magic fairy cleaned your thing as well.
Yeah, well, look at that. So good. Okay. Oh, look at this. That.
Oh, Shiv,
it's looking.
Oh, that smells good.
And look at the, you know, it looks so juicy. It's so charred. You can do this on a barbecue if you want to.
Yep.
So easy in the, under the grill, though, isn't it? All right. So whilst that's resting, it needs a couple of minutes rest time. We can get on with the rest of our gorgeous kebab.
That chicken looks incredible.
I know it is. And it smells. And you can see how juicy it is. It's not dry. It's juicy, beautiful chicken. So I've got a couple of options. Flatbread and pita. So I'm going to show you both. I don't know what Ro prefers, so...
What do you like?
I think flatbread.
Yeah, me too, yeah.
I like it kind of more open.
Mm.
So I've got my pita and flatbread. Both have been pre-toasted, which makes it easier to work with and easier to just break that pita down the side like that.
Very good.
Yeah, so just remember that step. And I'm just filling or topping with tzatziki first so you don't get any bit of dry bread. Nobody wants a bit of dry bread. OK, and then now I'm going to go in with shredded lettuce. What I love about this stage of kebab making, the art of kebab making, is it's a great fridge forager. Whatever you find in the fridge that needs using up, throw it on. Char-grilled peppers, olives, hummus, chili, pickles, jalapenos are a beauty in this as well. So loads of shredded lettuce. Some juicy slices of sweet tomato in there. I'm also going to put that on top.
You've got to ask me first before you put it in.
Salad, boss?
Yes, boss. Yeah. Get it in there.
I love it. OK, now these gorgeous chicken thighs are quite big, so I'm going to go for one per pita. So here, look at this. I am absolutely salivating over this. There we go. I'm going to make it
goodness.
A few more bits of onion there. and then some extra tzatziki on top, another tomato. You want all the fillings to look like they are falling out here.
Oh, this smells absolutely gorgeous.
It is absolutely wonderful. So, if you're going to do this flatbread version, I'm going to show you how to roll it, Martin. I'm going to add a little bit more tomato and a bit more tzatziki on the top. Now, here is where we get our greaseproof paper. You roll up the bottom first.
Yeah.
And then roll up the sides in like that and in like that. As typical style, I've overstuffed my kebab, so there we go. So, I make a little pocket like that. Yeah, and then this rolls up like that. And then all you're going to do is roll this around like this. There we go. And look at that. And then a couple of wedges of lemon to hold it in place. Twist that around a bit more. Give that a good squeeze.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah, gorgeous. I'm going to add a little bit more tzatziki here just to give a little bit of that look. Stuff it with a bit more red onion. And look at that.
All right, not too much, mate.
Is that enough?
Shiv, I'm begging you. Can I have yours? I'm begging you.
Of course you
I'm
can.
Actually begging
I will
you.
Have mine.
Yeah, great.
Yeah.
Yeah. For the first time ever,
of
I might have to swap.
Look,
I might have to swap.
There we go. And would you believe, for the pita bread option, it comes up to just under £1.30 a person. Far cheaper than going into a kebab shop.
Oh, look at that. Look, that looks absolutely
gorgeous.
Phenomenal.
As yours, bro.
Saturday supper sorted.
This is, I'd say, that's corner shop. This is gourmet. Do you know what I mean?
Let's have a taste then.
Can we try it? Let's have
Yeah.
I'm going to go for this one.
God, this looks phenomenal. Might have to take a little bit of that coriander.
I know, sorry, I've gone a
all right, no worries, no worries.
Coriander craze.
No worries, oh, my goodness. That is absolute knockout. Shiv, you have revolutionised chicken kebab.
Mm.
Oh, amazing.
Oh, wow.
But all the details on how to make Shivi's quick chicken kebab, head over to itv.com/food. Looking forward to seeing you next Saturday.
Cannot wait.
All right.
Very good, right. Yeah. And then we'd also love to wear your aprons on the show, so mum, stop emailing us and sending in your ones and let other people do it. So if you want to send in your aprons to weekendbest@cactustv.co.uk.
Yeah, time for a break, but don't go anywhere, because we're going to be meeting our Weekend Best VIP. And once again, it is a very interesting person.
Oh, my God, this one is so talented. You will not believe what they can do. Plus, we've got some great TV and film recommendations coming your way. See you in a bit.
See ya. Martin and Roman's Weekend Best. We've got Chris Kamara.
Yeah.
And Kem Cetinay. Yeah.
Okay, now I've got to ask just quickly. Obviously, Cammy's not having one because he's veggie. Kem.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Honestly, I swear on my life, it's unbelievable.
That's my line.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, you say it for me.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Honestly, so nice. Now, honestly, bang, you can't make this, can you? No
anyway,
chance.
Moving on, it will be the perfect accompaniment to the next bit of the show. It's time for some fantastic TV and film recommendations in...
Our best picks. Now, if you're looking for a good reason to get out of the house this weekend, then look no further. And my pick of the week this week, right, is the music documentary, The Summer of Soul, which is in cinemas right now. Now, it's featuring incredible, unseen performances from soul legends like Nina Simone, Stevie Wonder, and so many more. It tells a story of the Harlem Cultural Festival, which took place the same year as Woodstock. It is absolutely brilliant. Take a look at this.
I didn't expect a crowd like that. Something very important was happening. It wasn't just about the music.
1969 was a change of era in the black community.
The styles were changing.
Music was changing.
And revolution was coming together.
We are a new people. We are a beautiful people.
You know, I never even knew about that festival. You know, and I love that music. I love it. I never knew that.
Fantastic. Stevie Wonder on the drums there. Oh,
so great.
Absolutely incredible. Fantastic. Now, if you're still on a little bit of a downer after the Euros, this might help fill a football-shaped void in your life. My pick this week is the absolutely brilliant football comedy Ted Lasso. It's all about American football coach Ted, who moves to the UK to give British football coaching a go with absolutely no experience or knowledge of the profession. It's a little bit like our current government. And if you want any more proof of how good it is, it just landed 20 Emmy Award nominations. We've actually got a clip of the new series. Take a look.
Okay, so, fellas, let's go ahead and give Danny a little bit of space right now, yeah? Y'all don't mind showering at home, do you?
Oh, Coach, if it's okay with you, some of us prefer to take long baths at home.
Yeah, no, okay, that'll work, too. Okay. Oh, and hey, way to play out there today. Y'all kick their butts from soup to nuts. Don't worry, we're gonna get a W soon. We'll see you goldfish on Monday.
Goldfish?
By means to forget our mistakes and failures and just move on.
But I didn't make any mistakes. Only you played poorly.
Oh, wow. And series one and two of Ted Lasso are available on Apple TV Plus now. And Chris Kamara, I hear we might be having a little cameo from you.
Pardon the pun, yeah. Cameo is in Ted Lasso.
Yeah. Oh,
me and Jeff Stelling, for two episodes, we're in where they come on, Ted comes on Soccer Saturday. And is part of the panel.
Amazing. So,
yeah, it's great fun.
Incredible. Now, Kem, now, is it a silly question for me to ask, what are you going to pick for us to watch?
I feel like I can't say anything else than Love Island. I'm watching it every single night. I'm interviewing all the guests. I'm not watching anything else.
I mean, obviously, at the moment, like, it's starting to really kind of tense up.
I think the good thing with Love Island is that some people like the drama, some people like the love. You know, my mum likes to watch it and sit there going, oh, all the time when someone, like, flirting or going on a nice date. And then probably, I know what you're like, Roman, you probably like all the little arguments and the tears. Yeah. I can imagine you. You're like, what? That's what I mean. It's something for everyone. Like, literally, I feel like any age can watch it. Well, not any age, no one under, like, 16, but most ages can watch Love Island. And it's just a good show. It's so easy to watch.
Wicked. Some brilliant recommendations for you there.
Yeah, right. Time now to meet another Weekend Best VIP. That's very interesting person.
Yeah, they say you can't teach an old dog new tricks, but our next guest has taught her dog one of the coolest tricks ever. How to surf. Yes, you heard me correctly. How to surf. So let's head to Bournemouth and say hello to Vicky Mansfield and her super surfing pooch, Hugo!
Hey, how are you? Hi.
Listen, I think it's an absolutely fabulous idea, but where could we start? You know, I've got a little helper here, and I've got a board. Clover. Clover.
Come on.
There you go. Come here. There you go.
Go on.
So we're going to... Oh, she wants
it. Oh, nice. Hey. There we go.
Sit down there, Clover.
Sit down.
Sit down. That's it.
Sit
go
down.
On.
Oh, look at
and
that.
Look at her there.
The
look
way.
At her go.
Hey. Oh. Oh.
Oh, look at that, Clover.
Oh.
Try sit
down. You don't
down.
Need any lessons.
Oh, look at that. Show it off. Show it off, Clover. Go on. Give me your paw. Very good. Look at that.
Amazing.
Hey. Lovely. Well done, Clover.
Hey. Oh. So where do you start? How do you teach a dog to do this?
Well, I mean, it's all about relationship. So if you can get your dog to enjoy being on the board on the sand first, then you can take them out into the water. So you look at the board, you treat the board, you get them to put their feet up onto the board, and we also work on their body system as well. So we look at them anatomically. So we've got to make sure that their body is flexible, that they're strong, that they've got strength in their back legs, and they know where their forepaws are. I know that sounds bonkers, but if they don't know where their back feet are, they could fall off. So we teach lots of sort of foot awareness, and we work on the vestibular system, which is the middle ear, so that they don't get that imbalance, and we have to try and help them relax and be confident with movement under their feet.
But it's a natural thing anyway, isn't it? Because usually if a dog stands on a really small wall, you're just amazed at how it can balance.
Yeah, it's phenomenal. But you'll be surprised when they've got movement under their feet, how they lose the ability to know where their back feet are.
I mean, look, let's talk about it. Vicky, it's a big weekend for you, as tomorrow it is the Dog Surfing Championship.
Ooh. It's going to be a big day.
It's a very big day.
So you've got different categories, right, in the competition. You've got towel wagging, Right, yeah. Fair enough. And also tricks on the board. What sort of tricks do their dogs do?
Well, it can be anything from a high five to their owner to jumping on their back and jumping over onto the front of the board and then laying down as they come forwards. So if you can get them weaving around your legs at the same time, go for it. It's no hold bars. We just go for it.
You're also one of the judges as well. So what type of thing will get top marks from you?
We'll be looking at whether they're happy, whether they're confident, whether their tail's in a good place, whether their head's in a good place, whether they're able to ride that wave all the way in or whether they jump off too soon. So it's the ones that can stay on the longest, the ones that desperately want to get out there and do it again. They're the ones that we see as real champions. Yeah.
Fantastic. Oh, well, listen, Vicky, thank you so much, and big love to Hugo as well.
Thank you.
Well, that's your offer today. Yeah. If you fancy watching us all over again or you missed any of the show, you can catch up now on the ITV Hub.
Let's hear it for our wonderful guests, Kem Cetinay.
Woo! Chris Kamara.
And, of course, Shivi.
We're back tomorrow with an incredible lineup. We've got Jack Savaretti, we've got Rufus Sewell and Alfred Enoch.
See you tomorrow.
See ya. Woo!